This is my Bible. It is the Word of God and the will of God for my life. I am who the Word says I am. I am the righteousness of God in Christ. I am where the Word says I am. I'm seated right now in the heavenly realms, in the place of authority, dominion, and power. I have what the Word says I have. All the blessings of Abraham are mine, and I can do what the Word says I can do. I can do all things through Christ who gives me the strength. Today my mind is alert, my spirit is receptive, as I am taught the Word of God, my life is changed for the better, and I will never be the same again. Amen. You may be seated. If you would, turn in your Bibles to the Gospel of Luke and Luke chapter 15. And before I begin reading to you from Luke, I first want to read a few verses from Luke chapter 4. After Jesus had been baptized and after the Holy Spirit had come upon him, he went into the desert to be tempted for 40 days. And then after this, he went to his hometown of Nazareth, and there he stood up to speak, and he opened the Word of God. He opened the Scriptures, the scroll, to the prophet Isaiah. And he read this out of Isaiah. He said in Luke 4 and verse 18, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." The NIV says the year of the Lord's good favor. You know, this right here is what the ministry of Jesus is all about. And the Bible says that Jesus, he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so what the gospel is all about, what Jesus is all about, what the ministry of Jesus is all about has not changed to this very day. "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, the Lord's good favor." And see, we can never forget that this is what it's all about. And when you do, you become fossilized. You become hardened in your heart and you forget about what it's all about. And that is seeing people come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Now go to Luke 15. Luke 15, beginning in verse 1, to frame where we're going to be going today. Luke 15, verse 1. It says, "Then all the tax collectors and the sinners drew near to Jesus to hear him." Elsewhere in the Gospels, Jesus said, "I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." And he was criticized for it by the religious leaders for being kind and compassionate and loving and merciful to those who were far from God, who were lost, and ministering to those who were far from God. Now, I know some of these verses get heavily abused today. I know on social media, you know, people, they do all sorts of ridiculous things. They post their ridiculous photos of their sinful behavior, and they get asked about it, and they say, "Well, I'm just like Jesus. I'm eating and fellowshipping with seniors." With, not seniors, sinners. Although it is good to visit the nursing home and be a blessing. Amen. "I'm fellowshipping with sinners." You know the posts that I'm talking about. You've heard me say the only difference is when Jesus hung out with sinners, they got saved. Amen. Amen. I think of Zacchaeus. One encounter with Jesus, and his life was never the same. And Jesus went to eat at Zacchaeus' home. And because Zacchaeus had been a tax collector, had been a man who robbed people financially, the Pharisees and the religious leaders and the Sadducees, they criticized Jesus for doing what? For eating with sinners. I've not come to call the righteous but sinners to repentance. And so we see here the tax collectors and the sinners drew near to Jesus to hear him. Look at verse 2. This is who we can never be and should never be. And the Pharisees and the scribes complained, saying, this man receives sinners and eats with them. So then he spoke these parables. And so last week, we dealt with the parable of the lost sheep. We dealt with the parable of the lost coin. And today we're going to deal with the parable of the lost son. And we saw that when there is just one who comes back home to God, when there's just one person who repents of their sins, all of heaven rejoices. Amen. And it doesn't mean that heaven has forgotten about the rest of us. But on the day we were saved, on the day we were born again, all of heaven rejoiced at our coming to know Jesus Christ. Verse 11. Then Jesus said, a certain man had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. So he divided to them his livelihood. Now, biblically at the time, the older son received a double portion. And so this younger son, he would have gotten about a third of his father's estate. He said, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. So he divided to them his livelihood. Verse 13, and not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and journeyed to a far country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigal living. We could say sinful living, wasteful living. Picture that might come to mind is going to Vegas and living it up. Of course, now I hope you realize because of the technology that everything that is in darkness is going to be brought into the light, literally. I mean, you may delete it off of Facebook, but it's still on one of their servers somewhere. You may delete it off of Gmail, but it's still on one of Google's servers somewhere, which we know are tied into the NSA. You may delete it off of Instagram, but it's still on a server somewhere. And so this is one of the things that this generation, they're coming to realize and understand is that not only when you head down the wrong road, you've head down the wrong road and you pay the price for it, but it's recorded. That memory is recorded not just here, but now because of the time and the age in which we live, the memory of that's recorded on a server somewhere. And so he went and he squandered everything that his father gave him. It says he wasted his possessions with prodigal living, doing his own thing. Paul says in Romans that the wages of sin is what? Death. You know, why do we deal with sin? Why do we warn the young people about not heading down the road of sin and doing their own thing? You know, some people call it old-fashioned, I call it right. Some people call it traditional, I call it biblical. Because the wages of sin is death. And so when you do your own thing and head down your own road, and instead of doing it God's way or your father's way, you do it your way, there's going to be a heavy, heavy price to be paid. And it's not necessary. See, if you do things God's way, you'll walk in the blessing and the provision and the peace and the rest of God. But if you do things your way and the world's way and Satan's way, the enemy's way, you will pay a heavy price for it. The wages of sin is death. And Satan, sin, will make you a slave. And there are people, and they are not in control. Something is in control of them. Jesus said, I have come that you may have life and have it more abundantly, but the thief comes to do what? To steal, kill, and destroy. My six-year-old today asked me, what does Satan look like? Because she had watched a biblical cartoon where Satan was portrayed, of course, in the traditional way, scary, frightening, like a dragon. But the Bible refers to him as an angel of light. See, when he shows up to tempt people, he doesn't show you where you're going to end up if you live for him and follow him and live for yourself and live a worldly life for 10, 15, 20 years. He presents it in an attractive way, a fun way, an enticing way. Why? He is a deceiver. He doesn't show you where you're going to end up. He doesn't show you dying of some disease in the hospital. He's a deceiver. He is a liar. And think about it. He talked Adam and Eve out of the Garden of Eden. And he has had thousands of years experience tempting what? Tempting people like you and like me. So he wasted his possessions with prodigal living, wasteful living, sinful living, selfish living. Verse 14, but when he had spent all he had, the sad truth and reality is that for some people, for them to come to a saving knowledge of the truth, for them to wake up, for them to repent, for them to acknowledge God, they have to come to the very end. The end of themselves, the end of their money, they have to come to the point where they are desperate and they are hopeless. They have exhausted everything. But when he had spent all he had, there arose a severe famine in that land, and he began to be in want. He began to be in need. You know, there's a German proverb that says when the stomach grows hungry, the head begins to think. And we don't really get this in our culture today because there are so many safety nets. Amen. You know, and I believe in safety nets, but I believe in safety nets for a man that on behalf of our country went and gave his life in a war on foreign soil, and he's lost his arms or in his legs. I believe in that sort of safety net. But I don't believe in a safety net for somebody that will not work. The Bible says that if a man will not work, he should not what? See, somebody might say, oh, you're not compassionate. I'm compassionate for the people that need help. But if you're 35, living with your parents, with your 27-inch iMac in the basement, and you got the newest, latest, greatest iPad, it's time to go to work. It's time to be a producer. Amen. That's quiet. He had spent all he had, and there was a famine, and he began to be in want, in need. See, you might today think, oh, Pastor Gene, I don't know about that. Pastor Austin, I don't know about that. But see, just wait for the right circumstances in life, and then you'll be willing to acknowledge the truth of the Word of God. Now, should that be necessary? No. That's why we preach the way we do. That's why we warn people the way we do. A young person comes to me and says, you know, should I live together with someone? No. Why? Because of what the Bible says. Now you head down that road, you're going to end up with all the grief of heading down that road of sin. And our job is to rescue the perishing and to warn you and to do our best to get you, to keep you from heading down the wrong road so you don't have to pay the price, because the wages of sin is what? Death. See, there's this whole thing today. We just got to be loving, but we're not loving people if we don't warn them. We're not loving people if we don't attempt to rescue them. We're not loving people if we don't want and do everything in our power to see them avoid the wages of sin. And we can speak the truth in love, but we don't really love people if we're not willing to speak the truth in love. You go down this road, there's going to be disastrous results. I mean, the Bible says not to be unequally yoked, yet people do it all the time. You head down this road, you're unequally yoked in marriage, there's going to be disastrous results. See, it's our job to warn you. He began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country. Now, who is this? He's in a foreign land. He's not at home. So this Jewish boy, the younger brother that took his share of the inheritance and squandered it in wasteful and prodigal living, he's in a foreign land, spent all his money, there's famine, and so now he must go to a Gentile for help. And he sent him into his fields to do what? To feed what? The swine, the pigs. For a Jew, This would have been the lowest of the low in this life. For them, there would be no going lower. And you got to have the eyes to perceive, not just for a Jew. In Egypt, in Egyptian culture, there was such a stigma about swine and pigs that if you were a swine herder in Egypt, you were considered the lowest of the low, not even fit to marry the poorest of the poor. That is how ill-perceived swine were and swine herders were. And so he goes to a foreigner for help. He's sent into the fields to do what? To feed the swine. See, Satan will present things to you like it's a party, like it's fun. You're just living life, doing your own thing, like Oprah, expressing yourself, finding your own truth. But Satan will humiliate you every time. Sin will humiliate you every time. And I don't care what kind of sin it is, sexual sin, financial sin, any type of path of sin you head down, if you stay on that path and don't get off that path and don't repent and turn from that path, it'll lead you to a place of humiliation. It'll lead you to a place of humiliation. I mean, just think about what's going on in the news now and every week and how many people's lives and careers are being ruined because of a man that could not control himself with his cell phone or laptop. I mean, he didn't just mess himself up. He's messing up everybody around him. The wages of sin is what? Death. Humiliation. You see, Hollywood glamorizes sinful living. You see a movie about sinful living, they make it look glamorous. They make it look fun. I loved it in the message Jonathan mentioned. I don't know if it was here or somewhere else, but he mentioned in a message when he's in a big city and late at night after he does a church service, you know, you're in a big city, you get coffee, you're walking down whatever streets in a big city, and these clubs, they have the glass displays and you can see the sinners inside living it up. It's not glamorous when you really take a look. But see, that's not the way the world or Hollywood or TV presents it. The wages of sin is death, and it leads to humiliation. Verse 16, and he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate, but no one gave him what? Anything. See, if you look to God, he'll help you out. He'll bail you out. He's wonderful. He's gracious. He's loving. He's merciful. But when you head down this road of doing your own thing, squandering everything, you're on your own. And notice that no one gave him anything. And it says he coveted. He desired to even just eat what the pigs were eating. That's the ultimate humiliation. To eat, to desire, to covet, to want to eat what pigs are eating. Verse 17, but when he came to himself. See, there's a time in everyone's life when you must wake up, when you must come to yourself, when you must come to your senses, when you must wake up. You've heard me say, you must make the decision whether or not you're going to live for God, whether or not you're going to do things God's way, whether or not you're going to obey the word of God. Everybody's got to reach that decision for themselves. I don't care how long you've been in church. I don't care how on fire for God your parents might be or a brother or sister might be. You've got to wake up for yourself. The Bible says elsewhere in the New Testament, awake thou that what? Sleepest. And I don't believe you have to hit rock bottom to wake up, but I've seen it happen plenty of times. But why is that necessary? See, what was my father doing at 9? What am I doing now? We're laying out the word to warn people so they don't have to face and go through what this lost son did. And you can, and you can come home and you can be forgiven and restored. But why go through all of that in the first place? He woke up, he came to himself and said, how many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare? And I perish with hunger. I love what David said. He said, I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of the Lord. I would rather have the lowest position in my Father's house than have any position in Satan's kingdom. My Father's house, the servants, they have bread enough to spare, and I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my Father and will say, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me one of your hired servants. So he wakes up, he has an idea. I'll go home and I'll say, Father, I've sinned. I'm not asking you to take me back. I'm not asking you to accept me back. I'm just asking to be a servant in your house because I know your servants have it better than most people, and your servants have it better than I do right now. And he arose, verse 20, and came to his father, but he was still, when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had what? Compassion. And what had Jesus been dealing with the religious leaders about and the Pharisees about? Compassion. When he would go to a home like Zacchaeus's, when he would minister to those who are lost and sick and hurting and dying and suffering, and they would be critical, Jesus had been dealing with the religious leaders again and again and again about what? Compassion, mercy, love, not doing anything to lead one of the least of these astray, not doing anything to put a burden on someone's life they cannot what? Bear. His father saw him and had what? Compassion, and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Now here we have a beautiful picture of repentance and what repentance looks like. To come home, to repent, to say, Father, I have done what? I have sinned, I have transgressed against you. There are people today saying that all repentance is just changing something in your mind. Biblical repentance is much, much more than that. It is coming home to your Father. It is prostrating yourself before Him. What does that mean? To throw yourself on the ground before Him, to grab His garment, to humble yourself, and to cry out, Father, I have sinned against you. That's what repentance is. Then with the idea, the determination in your heart, you're not going to live that way anymore. You're not going to live as a prodigal anymore. You're not going to live in waste anymore. You're not going to run off every 6 months or every year to engage in this kind of living. This is repentance. Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Jesus, He paid the price so that we could be forgiven of our sins. He paid the price so that you could be a son or daughter of God. You could walk with God. But you know what comes first before you receive the gift of salvation? You know what comes first? Repentance. Repentance. See, John the Baptist preached repentance. Jesus, he went out preaching the kingdom of heaven is near. Do what? Repent. Peter, on the day of Pentecost, what did he say to the crowd? He said what? Repent. See, there are people and they think they're right with God and they're walking with God, but they've never what? Repented. Just that there explains why there is a disconnect in some people's lives. They think they're serving the Lord, but they're still doing their own thing. Verse 22, but the father said to his servants. See, this is what we should be like. See, do we imitate people or do we imitate our Father? We imitate our Father. Bring out the best robe and put it on him. And put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet. Now, I know everybody in America in 2016 thinks sandals are humble or hipster, one or the other. But in this day, only the wealthy wore sandals. Servants never wore sandals. So he comes home, just hoping his father will accept him back and make him a servant. He comes home and he repents, and his father welcomes him and has compassion on him. He says, bring out the best robe. Put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet. Bring the fatted calf here and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. Let us eat and rejoice. For this, my son, he was dead and he is alive again. He was lost and he is what? Found. And they began to be what? Merry. Now, there are two ways to look at this. See, there are some of you today, and you're struggling with receiving from God. You're struggling with believing from God because you have been a lost son or a lost daughter, and you've gone off and you've done your own thing, and you've come home. You've asked God's forgiveness. You've repented, but you haven't seen yourself the way the Bible sees you. You haven't seen yourself the way God sees you, that you are forgiven, that you are restored, that you are a part of the family of God, and you are not a servant, you are not a slave, you are a son, you are a daughter, and so your wonderful Heavenly Father, you may not have eyes to see it, but He has put on you a robe of righteousness, a garment of righteousness, a pure white garment. And He has put a ring on your finger signifying that you're a son or a daughter. You're a part of the family that you have, because of what Jesus did, the authority of the family. And He has put on you sandals that show that you are blessed, you are wealthy, you are prosperous, you have no needs because of who your father is. But see, because of religion, maybe because of background, you struggle with that, and you think because of going off and doing your own thing, whatever it was, you say, I believe I'm forgiven, but you think you're not qualified for the robe. You think you're not qualified for the ring and for the sandals. You think you're not qualified to be a son or a daughter. And so you're home, you're in the house of our Father, but you're living at the level of a servant or slave. That's why you got to know what the Word says. That's why you got to believe what the Word says. When He forgives us, He separates our sins from us as far as the east is from the west. They're gone. And look, why do we warn young people the way we do? Because it's not that God won't forgive them. It's that they'll remember the road they went down. And Satan is mean. Satan is mean. And people that are full of Satan are mean too. And they'll remind you of what you did. And they'll remind you of how you messed up and did your own thing. But it's under the blood of Jesus. We sing that song, what can wash away my sins? Nothing but what? The blood of Jesus. It's washed away. It's gone. It may be on a government server somewhere, but you're forgiven. Amen. It may be in the basement at the NSA, but you're forgiven. You're redeemed. Amen. Who you sinned with, they may remember, but you're forgiven. You're redeemed. Amen. And so you've got to have eyes to see it. You've got the robe on. You've got the ring on. You've got the shoes on. You've been welcomed home to the family of God. And you, not because of what you did, not because of the price you paid, but because of what Jesus did on the cross, you are qualified to receive all the benefits and blessings of the kingdom. See, there are good things to every tradition, but there are some negative things to some traditions. And sometimes one thing Pentecostal people have trouble with is believing they're qualified to receive the blessings of God. And we head down this road of thinking, if I can only just do enough of this and enough of that, I'm qualified because of what Jesus did for me. Hallelujah. I'm qualified because of what Jesus did for me. Amen. If you could receive the greatest gift, which is salvation, by grace, why are you having trouble receiving anything else from God? It is yours. It belongs to you. You're a son. You're a daughter of God. Now, this is one way to approach this. But the flip side of this is here. We've got to, those of us that have come home, we've got to remember what God brought us out of. And we've got to always be mindful of having the heart of Jesus and the compassion of our Father. Amen. You know, Pastor was talking about in the 9 a.m. service that we're seeing something new, and that is the young people of parents who left many, many years ago, young people of those parents coming home. My father said at 9 a.m., he's seeing young people come home that he held and he dedicated as children. And some of them, they went down rougher paths than others. Some of them, God set them free and delivered them from more. And it's always tempting for people to say, well, because of all that, you know, God can use this one for great things, but we don't know if God will ever be able to do something with so-and-so. See, that's not faith talking. That's not the Bible talking. That's not the love and the mercy and the grace of God talking. All things. Jesus said what? All things are possible for the man or the woman who believes God. So see, as we see people come home, as we see the people we're praying and fasting on their behalf, they come home and they repent. See, we're not to look down on people like the Pharisees. We're not to have hard hearts toward people like the Pharisees. We're not to say, well, why is Pastor Gene, why is Pastor Austin so kind to so-and-so? Don't they know what they've done? We don't need to know. All we need to know is the grace of God. Now, I want to clarify something right here. Grace does not mean lying to people. Grace does not mean you can stay in sin and be right with God. We actually got an email. People are amazing. Got an email maybe a month ago from a woman living in sin. Why do you say that, Austin? That's kind of harsh. Well, in her email, she says it. It took her about a paragraph, but I just boiled it down to three words: living in sin. Talking about her spiritual gifts. Look, if you're in sin, there ain't no spiritual gifts in operation. Amen. It may be the gift of fornication, but it ain't a spiritual gift. And basically, it was this long email saying, we're living in rebellion against God, but can we come to your church and be accepted and be part of the family and serve in leadership? No. No. I didn't respond. I just deleted it. But see, that's the attitude of this culture today. I'm with every year I'm learning. I don't have to respond to everything. Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. I don't have to respond to every Facebook message or email or tweet. Amen. I can block people. I can delete them. Amen. That's for somebody today. But that's this generation. They're living in sin and rebellion against God, wanting to have all the blessings and the benefits of walking with God. And it's a lie. It doesn't work. See, the great Jesus went to the cross so that in my life and my sin, however I've messed up, whatever road I've gone down, I can be forgiven. I can be set free from the power of any sin, bondage, or addiction. I can be put in a robe of white, and then I can spend the rest of my life walking with God, living for the kingdom of God, being light in a dark world. See, people today, they want to walk around as darkness and say they're children of the kingdom of God. They've not been set free. And love is not lying to people. Love is speaking the truth in love. Brother, sister, you're headed down the wrong path. You're in the bondage and iniquity of Satan, but God loves you. He paid the price for you. The Holy Spirit is here. You can be set free, and you can be loosed from those chains of darkness forever. We've got to be willing to speak the truth. That's what we're facing today. Verse 25, now his older son was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And the servant said to him, your brother has come, and because he has received him safe and sound, your father has killed the fatted calf. But he was angry and would not go in. Therefore, his father came out and pleaded with him. So he answered and said to his father, "Lo, these many years I have been serving you." You know, it's interesting how the Holy Spirit deals with us. On the one hand, somebody's the lost son, they're a prodigal off in a foreign land in sin, and what does the Holy Spirit do? He convicts them. But then on the flip side of that, you're the other brother, and you're home, and you're at home, and you're doing what's right. And yet there are things in your heart that are hardened towards those who are lost, hardened towards those who are perishing, hardened where a brother or a sister has come home. You don't love them. You're not merciful to them. You don't have compassion toward them. And the Holy Spirit is speaking to you, pleading with you to stop that, to knock it off. But look at how he answered his father. "Lo, these many years I have been serving you." See, is that how you see your relationship with your father? That it's a chore? That there's a million things you would rather do, but I'm serving you. Is that what any parent wants to hear? Clean your room. What's your problem? I'm serving you. See, is that how some of us treat our Heavenly Father? Not doing these things with joy in our heart and gladness in our heart, but doing these things with the attitude, I'm serving you. I've been serving you. Now look at the next phrase. How can this be true? See, this young man, he's no different from the rich young ruler. I've obeyed all the commands of God perfectly since I was a child without fail. Liar, liar, pants on fire. But see, this is a bad attitude. I have been serving you, and I have never transgressed. Your heart's not right. Your heart's not right with God. You see, I don't care how perfectly you've walked with the Lord in the last month, amen? There are all things that we need to work on and improve, amen? I said, I don't care how perfectly you've walked with the Lord in the last month. There are all things we need to work on and improve. Amen. Amen. And you think you've got it mastered? Just go to the fruit of the Spirit. Amen. And ask yourself, in the last 30 days, have you perfectly walked in love? Have you perfectly walked in joy and peace and patience and faithfulness and kindness and gentleness as you drove to work every day in rush hour traffic? I have been serving you. I never transgressed your commandment at any time. And yet you never gave me a young goat that I might make merry with my friends. Now look at what he says. But soon as this son of yours. I mean, imagine speaking that way about a brother or a sister. And so you have to have eyes to see it. Today, we're not just talking about a family, we're talking about the family of God. And as soon as somebody comes home, as soon as somebody repents, as soon as a brother or sister repents, they're forgiven, they're restored, they're redeemed, they're brought into the family of God, they're a brother or a sister in Christ, and we got to treat them accordingly. And not be looking down on them and not be despising them. And not be despising the fact that they've been forgiven and restored and brought home. And not have the attitude, this son of yours, this daughter of yours. See, do you believe in the grace and the mercy of God, or do you not? That it can restore and forgive the worst of the worst. The lowest of the lowest, the most despised. But as soon as this son of yours came who has devoured your livelihood, with harlots, with whores. Now notice, see, we assume certain things. Well, the Bible says that Mary Magdalene had seven demons, so she was probably a big time whore. It just says she had seven demons. I mean, think about the way people talk about Rahab. Well, she, the Bible says, Brother Austin, she was an innkeeper. You know what an innkeeper means, right? See, it says that his brother, you go back, I flip my page back over, however your Bible has got this laid out. He squandered what his father gave him in wasteful living, but that's still generic. It doesn't give us the exact details. But notice his brother's running his mouth talking about whores. Now, is it possible part of it was with whores? Yes. But was his brother there? Was his brother with them? They didn't even have Facebook. And two, this is a parable. I saw on Facebook, Pastor Gene, did you see on Facebook? This son of yours, who has devoured your livelihood with harlots, you killed the fatted calf for him. And his father said to him, son, you are always with me, and all that I have is yours. See, as the children of God, you've got to remind yourself of that fact. We're a part of the kingdom. We're a part of the family of God. All that is in the kingdom is ours. It belongs to us. It is ours. But as those who are far from God come home, as the sons or daughters of parents, they've been praying for them and fasting for them. As they come home, we've got to welcome them. We've got to have compassion on them. We've got to see that they're discipled and that they're restored, and that we're a part of seeing the years the locusts have eaten be restored. That we're not hindering the work God is doing in their life. That while God is drawing, we're not pushing them away. All that I have is yours. It was right that we should make merry and be glad, for your brother was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. See, maybe you've been a prodigal. Maybe you've been lost. Maybe you went off and have done your own thing, and as Pastor said at 9, for years and years and years, you have struggled to walk in the fullness of the blessings of God that belong to you, because you feel like you're not qualified, you're not worthy to receive. It's time to tell yourself what the Word says. You're forgiven. Your sins are separated from you as far as the east is from the west. They're under the blood of Jesus. They have been washed away for all of eternity. But on the flip side, for the rest of us, we must be people of what? Compassion. People of love, people of mercy, people who have a heart like our Heavenly Father, people who minister like Jesus, that the number one thing we're about is seeing people come into the kingdom of God and seeing lost sons and lost daughters restored. You might say, Austin, I don't have a lost son or lost daughter. Can I challenge you in your prayer life? If you've been here any length of time, you probably know someone, you probably know of a family, and they have a son or a daughter that is not here. It's fine to pray about whatever you've got going on in your life. You should. But I want to ask you to pray for others. I want to ask you to intercede for others. There are families in this church, and a son or daughter is not here. Pray for them. Pray as Jesus prayed, that the Lord will bring laborers across their path to speak the right word at the right time into their lives. Because I believe we're going to see them all come home. Pastor said at 9, he believes that every child we've ever dedicated, we will see come home. Well, Austin, you don't know about what they're into. There is a power that is greater than the biggest power of Satan. And that is the power of the Holy Ghost. The power of God. No case is too hard. No case is too difficult. Until a person dies, no one is too far gone to come home and to receive grace and mercy. Please bow your heads. You might be here today, and perhaps you've never given your life to Jesus Christ. You've never accepted Him as your Lord and Savior. God loves you. And he sent his son Jesus. He lived for you. He lived a perfect, sinless life. And then he suffered and he died. He was crucified. He paid the price for your sins and for my sins. That the sin and the wrongdoing in your life would be washed away so that you could be forgiven and have a relationship with our wonderful Heavenly Father. The Bible says that there is a heaven to gain and a hell to shun, to avoid. This life, no matter how long it is short, it is temporal, it is passing away. The world will lie to you, it'll tell you you can do your own thing, you can live for yourself, you can be someone like this lost son, you can go off, you can do your own thing, you can find your own path, but it always leads to tragedy. It always leads to humiliation. The wages of sin is death. And so we have a choice. Will we give our lives to God? Will we accept Jesus Christ as his Lord, as our Lord and as our Savior? If we do, when this life comes to an end, we'll go to be with him and with our wonderful Heavenly Father for all of eternity. But if we reject him, if we reject him like people in his day rejected him, when this life comes to an end, we'll be separated from God for all of eternity. We'll go to a place the Bible calls hell, a place of eternal suffering, eternal torment, no do-overs, no second chances. The way of escape is to give your life to God. The way of escape is to call out and to give him your life. If you're here today and you'd say, Austin, I've never done that. I've never made Jesus Christ my Lord and my Savior, but I know I need to, and I want to. If that's you today, please raise your hand. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Raise your hand. Thank you. You might also be here today, and at one point in your life, you prayed a prayer, you walked an aisle, but in your heart, you know you're a lost son. You know you're a lost daughter. People around you, they may think that you've got it together. Maybe you know how to say the right words and make people in your family and people at church and your friends think you're living for God. But you know in your heart, you're far from the Lord. You know in your heart, you're not right with God. You know in your heart that if something happened to you, if you died today, you do not know, or you know, you would not go to spend eternity with God. The mercies of God are new every morning. But you must do as that lost son did. You must come to your Father. You must repent of your sins. You must say, Father, I have sinned against you, but I've come home. If you're here today and you say, Austin, that's me. I need to recommit my life. I need to come home. I need to make things right with our Heavenly Father today. If that's you, please raise your hand. Thank you. Thank you. See the hands? We're going to pray. If you raised your hand for either invitation, repeat this prayer after me. And the rest of us, let's pray along with them as a show of support. Pray this prayer. Repeat after me. Heavenly Father, I repent of my sins. I repent of going my own way, of living for myself, of living for the world. Today I give you my life. I believe that Jesus, he paid the price for my sins. And I believe that you raised him from the dead. Today I make Jesus my Lord and my Savior. Thank you for welcoming me into your family. From this day forward, I will live for you. I will be in church, and I will live for you the rest of my days. I give you my life, and I ask you to set me free from anything that would hinder me in living for you. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Now you have to have eyes to see it from the Word. You're forgiven. You're restored. You're redeemed. So what does your Heavenly Father do? It says he brings out the best robe and puts it on you. He puts a ring on your hand and sandals on your feet. And so you say, oh, you don't know what I did. It's under the blood of Jesus. It's been washed away. Amen. And you know, look, I gave you some practical advice. You may want to clean up your Facebook page now. Amen. your online account so everybody knows that a change has happened, a change has taken place. Amen. Don't keep those old photos on there for posterity. Amen. Delete them. Amen. God has done a work. You're forgiven. You're restored. You're redeemed. Today is a new beginning, a new start. Amen. The Bible says that those that are rooted and planted in the house of the Lord, they flourish. That's why we're here every Sunday, every Wednesday night. Amen. To show you the way to walk with God and to experience His best. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen.